Welcome back, everybody. Another exciting and hopefully educational video today from Blue Glow Electronics. Thought I'd take on an interesting topic here, one I've been perplexed with myself over time, and there's really just not a lot of good easy answers, but I want to try to break it down for you and show you how to go about it. So the question is simple, and you would think the answer would be really simple, but let's look at what the question is here. The question is basically, you know, what do we want to know about a capacitor, especially one that's inside of, you know, maybe a piece of vintage gear. If any of you guys watched the latest restoration of the Scott unit, I still got it here on the bench. Listening to it, to be honest, but there were a lot of capacitors in there, and we were trying to decide on some of them whether to replace them or not. But you know, in trying to determine that, you know, what are the things we want to know? Well, there's about four questions here that I've written down that we would really want to know about any old capacitor. All these should look very familiar to you. You've seen ones just like this in lots of audio gear used over the years. You know, a plain old can, multi-section electrolytic capacitor. You know, some old wax paper style coupling capacitors, old bumblebee, just some good old film capacitors, and yet another old electrolytic here. But the first question we would want to ask ourselves is, what's the value of the capacitance? So, you know, if you're looking at this unit and you read it here, it's a 0.047 microfarad capacitor at 600 volts is what it says, right? Well, you'd want to know, is that still true? That thing was probably built, this capacitor was probably built in the, if I was guessing, early 50s, late 50s, maybe somewhere in the 1950s. So, you know, is it still a 0.047 microfarad capacitor? The second question you might want to ask, does it leak? In other words, is it performing its job as a coupling capacitor and blocking the DC in one stage from the DC in the next stage, and only allowing the AC or audio signal to flow through? If it's letting DC flow through from one stage of an amplifier to another, then that DC coming off of one stage can greatly affect the parameters, otherwise known as bias, of the next stage, which can cause all kinds of crazy things to happen in your amplifier. So if this thing's leaking and letting DC flow through, it's a bad thing, and probably not one you would want to use in your circuit. The third question we would want to ask here is, does this thing have some internal resistance to it? In other words, you know, does it produce heat? In other words, if you hooked a, say, an ohm meter across, you know, the, maybe the positive and the negative of this with an ohm meter, you know, would you measure resistance in there? Which, with a capacitor, you really shouldn't have a lot of resistance. But if you've got resistance there, well, you know, some of the other lessons we've learned, how do resistors operate? Well, they drop voltage by generating heat, basically. And so, you know, does this thing somehow generate heat inside the capacitor and create voltage? The downside to creating heat inside of a capacitor, and we'll talk about it a little bit more in a minute, is it further degrades the capacitor. It's kind of a slippery slope, short path to death there, and we'll talk more about that. And then the last question here, does this capacitor break down at higher voltage? In other words, let's say we tested this thing at a low voltage and it tests fine, but then you put it into a circuit here with 600 volts going across it, and what happens at 600 volts could be very different than what happens at 2 or 3 volts. So you know, that seems like a simple question here. What would we want to know about the capacitor? The value of it? Does it leak? Internal resistance? And does it break down at higher voltage? God, those would seem like simple questions. You could just go get simple answers to all of them. Well, I'm going to show you it's not that simple to get these answers. The other thing, if you notice, I drew an arrow between these two. These two are kind of related to each other. You rarely see one that has that is leaking that doesn't have internal resistance generating heat. It's kind of the way these things break down that these two happen together. So you very rarely see one of those without the other. But let's jump on over and talk about how we answer these questions here, right? So the steps we would take, and you know what, the steps seem really simple. First, we would do a visual inspection. You've probably seen many capacitors that have been bulged on the end or popping. Let me give you an example here. See this little capacitor right here? It's kind of hard to see, but you see the lead here for this one. We'll see this black stuff squirting out the side of that, kind of climbing up the top there. Well, that is the internal guts of this capacitor starting to leak out, which tells me this thing is having some internal issues, and we'll talk about a little more about that in a minute. So a visual inspection could be your first step in knowing whether a capacitor is good or not. The second one, you could touch it or feel it for heat. You know, you could actually, this thing's sitting in the unit, it's been running for 5 or 10 minutes. You know, you could come along, put your finger on the top of it. Make sure it's not a positive can set up. If it is, you might not want to ground yourself with the other hand to the chassis. But you know, you touch it and feel it and see if it's putting off heat. You know, let me show you another way you could go about it. Yeah, if you're scared to put your hand in the circuit, these little things have gotten cheap enough these days. You can get one for about $15 or $20. It's a little laser digital thermometer. What happens when you pull the little trigger on it, it shoots out a little laser light. You can see the red light there on the capacitor, and it basically reads the temperature exactly there. So that capacitor is about 75 degrees. Kind of warm down here in my basement, but you could do the same over here on this one, and that one's sitting at 74 degrees. But you know, let's say you shot a couple of them in a circuit and most of them were at say 75 or 80 degrees, but all of a sudden you find one that's at 90 degrees or 100 degrees. Well, you know that thing's generating a lot of heat. Well, what generates heat? Resistance. And then you would know you probably got some leakiness. So it's a good little thing. The other thing I use these for, you can check tubes in an amplifier. You can kind of tell whether any of them are running hot or not. You can shoot the little red dot that it generates there onto varying tubes and see if there's a difference between the heat they're generating. If there is, there's probably a difference in the bias. One's pulling more current than the other, and probably something you should look at and address. At any rate, so visual inspection is simple enough, right? Touch and feel, that's pretty simple enough. Then this is where it all falls apart. You need to, one, test the value. Two, you need to test the equivalent series resistance. And three, you need to test at a high voltage to see if this thing's going to break down. Well, all the rave that these things are these days, I'm going to show you how this one cannot do all three of those. This is a LCR meter, inductance, capacitance, resistance meter. It cannot do all three of these. And this is just a plain old multimeter with the capacitance value on it. It cannot do all three of these. So you're probably scratching your head saying, wow, show me that. So let's do a little demo here. Okay. By design, these ESR meters are designed to do two functions with the simple push of a button. The first one is to determine capacitance value, so number three here, and two, to test the equivalent series resistance, ESR. So by design, this meter is designed to do both number three and number four. It is not designed to do number five. This is a low voltage device. It uses two or three little bitty, you know, size of a quarter, little bitty flat battery cells, almost like hearing aid batteries. Certainly, they're operating at 1.5 volts, so certainly not going to test anything at high voltage. So let's turn this thing on and see what happens here. This is that old 0.47 600 volt Sagamo capacitor. Okay, monitoring, analyzing. Whoops, it can't read it. Open circuit or low capacitance. Well, what the heck's going on? Here's what's going on. These, let's put in one here. This is a 0.1 microfarad, right? This is an old Cornell doubler. Wax, I call them wax paper capacitors, because that's kind of what they're made out of. Here it goes analyzing. Can't measure a 0.1. Here's the deal. These types of capacitance testers here are really designed to test more electrolytic capacitors things of a little bit higher value, they really just don't go down that low in their ability to test capacitance. So we can't test number one, number three, or number four using this with audio coupling capacitors. So what good is it? Well, it's good for electrolytics, and we'll show you that in a minute. Okay, well then we've got this Atlas LCR meter, which is a device designed to test inductance, capacitance, and resistance. And it would help if I'm hooking up the right stuff here. Let's clip that on. Let's clip this on. Doing all this one-handed while holding the camera in the other. I'm learning new skills. All right. Analyzing in 4, 3, 2, 1. Analyzing. And it comes back and tells me 62.4 nanofarads. And if you hit the down button, the only other thing this can tell you is, hey, I used a 1 kilohertz tone to do that test. So let's test it one more time here. 4, 3, 2, 1. 62.4, I'll bet. 62.38. Pretty much the same. At any rate, you can use an LCR meter here, just like this, to test the value of low value capacitance. So we achieve number three. This is not an LCR meter, so it cannot do number four. It operates off the same 1.5 volt battery, so it cannot do number five. So all I know right now about these coupling capacitors here is that their value. I don't know if they're generating heat, or if they've got, you know, some breakdown going on inside, and I don't know how they operate at higher voltage. So let me show you what it takes to do that. All right, this is the newest addition to my bench. You can achieve the same thing that this meter is doing by using a high voltage power supply, such as the old Heath kit IP17 that I've got up here. As well as you know, leveraging the current meter on it, or in sticking an in-line current meter. But this, you know, I've been wanting one for a while. I've been doing it this way, but I really wanted one of these. I started searching online, and you know, followed auctions for a month or two. Finally, ended up finding it, basically a new in the box one. Paid a little bit of a premium for it, but this thing is beautiful, not a scratch on it, and it's kind of like the way I like the way I have. Like the way I would like to have all my test gear up here. Anyway, there's really two sides to this meter. This is a Sprague tel-ohmike TO-6A capacitance analyzer. And there's really two sides to this thing. The first side, which is kind of, you know, kind of made up of this meter over here, these settings, and really this one lever here. You really don't use the middle knob. You don't use the seeing eye tube here. You don't use the power factor piece to do one type of test, and that type of test is basically a high voltage test to determine if a capacitor is either leaking or breaking down. Kind of the other half of the meter allows you to kind of what these buttons over here do, along with this tuning eye and this knob here. They will let you dial in and tell the value of the capacitance. I will tell you, it's kind of a long, convoluted way of measuring the value of capacitance. You're probably better off grabbing a meter like this that'll quickly tell you the value, and then coming over here to this thing to actually do the high voltage breakdown. So the way this thing's going to work is you got really a couple different settings here from a voltage standpoint. So up to 6 volts, up to 60 volts, and up to 600 volts is the setting. And I've got it on the 600 volts. And then what you do is you push this white button here in the middle, and this little needle goes over, and I've already adjusted the voltage knob here. You know, if I adjust it a little bit to the left, you'll see the needle goes not quite as far. And maybe I can hold that down, and I'm gonna crank this thing right on up there near 600 volts, right? So this thing's set with an internal high voltage power supply right now to generate 600 volts out these two leads, which I've got coupled up to a BNC connector, which I've got coming down to basically the other end of the BNC connector is connected right here. And so when you flip this knob here over from discharge to test, it applies 600 volts to this capacitor. So if I grab those leads right now, I would know it. But the good news is this thing right now is measuring milliamps of current, and it's over here on this setting, so it would go from 0 to 60 milliamps of current. Even at the 6, so that would be 0 to 6 milliamps, even at the 0.6, so if that's 0.6 milliamps, 0.04 milliamps of current this thing is leaking. So this thing is a great capacitor. It's in good shape and it's operating at 600 volts. So guess what? This tester up here, and I'm going to flip this back over to the other side. The thing I like about this unit, when you test it over here, it actually shorts these two out across the resistor inside that unit, and it, over 5 seconds, will discharge this capacitor completely down. So whatever charge was placed into it is now gone. So, what did the good old trusty Sprague tel-ohmike meter tell us here? It, one, told us the ES, it told us the ESR because basically we watched it, whether it leaked or not. We also could tell that it didn't break down at high voltage. I could have used it to test the value, but it's an old meter, and the way you get to that is fairly long and complex. I mean, you can get used to it, and you could do it that way. It's just not highly precise. I would much recommend just throwing one of these across the leads, getting your value really quick, then coming up here and using this unit just for the sole purpose of testing the capacitor for leakage at high voltage. So between this meter and the Sprague meter, we were able to answer all three of these questions quite simply. Let's take a look at a few other things now. Okay, so we said earlier these meters were really designed for electrolytics, and they do quite well with electrolytics. So let's see what happens here. We turn this thing on. It's monitoring for component. It's analyzing. It came back and said, whoa, we've got 101 microfarad. And if I look at the value on the side here, it should be 80 microfarad. So it's climbed a little bit over time. And two, it's telling me it's got an equivalent series resistance internally at 0.29 ohms. That's incredibly low. So this, according to this meter, this capacitor is in great shape. However, let's test something out here. Okay, we've tested this capacitor here out on the Atlas ESR, which said it was in really great shape. And now I've got it hooked up here to the Sprague meter. And if you'll notice here, push the button and we end up here at 450 volts is what we've got going on right now. A little bit less than 450 volts. And if I flip this, flip the switch here and put it in test mode, you notice it jumped up a good little bit here. And then if I change it over to the 6 milliamp scale, it's climbing down a little bit. What's happening right now is the capacitor is actually charging. But I can tell you that this thing will bottom out and hang around somewhere in this 3 milliamp range right here that you're seeing. It just doesn't go much lower than that. I let it sit a minute ago for about 10 minutes, and that's about where it hung out at. Any rate, you can come over here, and this is the handy manual for the Sprague meter. And there's a chart here that tells you, at 400 volts and of 70 microfarads here, come across the little thing. It tells you that this is actually an 80 microfarad capacitor, so it might be slightly harder. The next line down is the 100. But you can see here, 1.06 milliamps should be the maximum that this thing, and even if it was 100 microfarad capacitor, 1.27. So we're somewhere around three times that right now of current leak coming through this thing, which is probably not great for the next stage of your amplifier to have 3 milliamps of current kind of flowing through to the other side. So, you know, I would consider this thing somewhat marginal. Mike could be used in a pinch, but all the effort and time it would take to solder this thing in or whatnot, I probably wouldn't use it, even though this thing said, you know, hey, this thing looks great with three times the amount of leakage current than what the book is telling you is maximum. That's not average or what it should be. It's telling you absolute maximum, three times that. Tells me this thing's you know, leaking internally, especially at the high voltage there. So if you think about it now at this point, we've really been able to test the value of a capacitor, and these things here do a great job of that. It tests the ESR. Well, you know, we've been able to do that, and then we've also been able to test the test this thing at high voltage to see if there's any difference between that and what you've got in the other values, and we're able to do that, you know, using this handy dandy Sprague meter here that is designed for high voltage. You know, I would tell you, if you were a you know, someone that mainly worked on, let's say, Marantz gear, Pioneer gear, Sensui, whatever, just solid state stuff, where you're mostly dealing with you know, capacitors like of this nature, you know, that are you know, probably down in the 60 to 30 to 50 to 60 volt range, you'd probably be fine getting by with one of these and nothing else. Other than you might need a you know, a capacitance tester for you know, just testing the values on audio coupling capacitors, because this thing won't go down and read that low. The challenge you've got is, what if you're trying to test an audio coupling capacitor at high voltage, you know, at 600 volts? You really end up having to, because since this can't even read it, you're really, this, you know, this Sprague up here is really your only option I see for effectively testing, you know, audio coupling capacitors at high voltage, you know, for tube circuits. You can do what I used to do. You can build a, you know, you can basically put high voltage across the thing with this, with an ammeter inline, which is basically exactly what we're doing here. And you can get to pretty much the same value. So at any rate, I'm going to take you on to the next phase here and show you what got me fired up about testing capacitors. Okay. If any of you guys have been watching my videos, you know, I keep parts in these little bins and I label them. It's just much more efficient for me than the drawers. But you know, I keep a lot of these poly caps on hand, varying size and values, you know, Russian paper and oil type caps, you know, varying types here that I keep in stock for when I need to replace the coupling capacitors in an amp. I also keep a pretty good selection here of, you know, these Sprague orange drop capacitors. But you know, these things, you know, these things can run anywhere from $1 to $3 and $4 a piece, depending on the size. You know, these 0.1 microfarad, 600 volts, this thing can get on up in the $4 and $5 a piece type range. Similar to some of these things, some of these, and the Russian paper and oils, you know, some of the larger capacitors here, 0.47. You know, these can get up into $1, $2, $3 a range each. In fact, some of these good ones like this can get on up into $5 and $10 area caps. Those things can be, you know, $5, $10, $15, $20 a piece. Yeah, so there's hundreds of dollars here at least. Maybe I don't know, if I had to guess, it's somewhere between $500 and $1,000 worth of capacitor sitting here. Well, I was out and about a couple, 2-3 months ago, around September, and I was at a flea market and I ran into this guy, and he had these blue bins, you know, the ones with the little drawers, and he had about 4 of them sitting there, and they were full, honestly, of new old stock capacitors. And I can't even begin to tell you how many new old stock capacitors here are in this box. There are everything, old brown dog bones, tons and tons of the orange drops. You've got everything here from you know, Sprague fel-ohmikes, to, let's see, black beauties down in there. We've got, vitamin C sprays. Somewhere here there was an entire bag. Look at that. It's crazy. Godman's, those are good caps. Let me check this out. Entire bag of 0.1 600 volt sprayed vitamin C's. Those things are like $20-$25 a piece on eBay. Anyway, it's just, they kind of go on and on and on what's in here. But, and I asked the guy, I said, what do you want for this? And I thought he was going to give me a price per capacitor type thing, you know, maybe two for a dollar or something like that, maybe a dollar a piece, I don't know. But what he came back with was basically, well, you know, I'd like to sell the bins as a whole. And he said, I'd kind of like to get, $15, maybe $20 for each bin. And I said, okay. I said, how about I take all four of them for $10 a piece? And he was fine with that. So I bought, that's got to weigh at least 40 pounds of capacitors for $40. And the guy was happy. I was happy. I didn't feel bad, mainly because a lot of these are old. I mean, this stuff, you could tell this came out of some TV or repair shop from years ago. These things weren't made in the last 5 years, let's say. They were probably made in the 50s, 60s, whatnot. And so, I was just taking a gamble that these, half of these may be bad. I don't know. So that's what got me fired up, was to, bring that, get the sprig and get it fired up. And literally, I want to go through now. I've broken them down thus far by size. But as you can see, I've got a mixture of types in here. Some of the old brown dog bones. I've got sprig capacitors in here, kind of all mixed in. So my next step would be to test all these kind of one by one as I'm sorting them, not only by size and voltage, but also by type. All right, let's talk a little bit about capacitor types and why some have held up better over the years and others haven't. So first off, if you look down here on this picture, what you really have is two pieces of metal foil separated by a dielectric material here. And that's how, that's the kind of the definition of a capacitor, two metal plates separated by some type of dielectric. Well, with these foil capacitors, typically the metal turns out to be really thin sheets of aluminum or something, and the dielectric is often paper. And so what happens is, over time, this paper draws moisture and it starts to break down as a dielectric material. So if you'll notice up here in the top left, you've got this Sagamo capacitor. It's kind of that same scenario encapsulated in plastic. Below that, you've got the orange drop here. It's kind of encased in a resin type material, which holds up pretty well. You get down here to the very bottom, that's a capacitor found in Fisher tube amps an awful lot. They do a pretty good job of holding up, but I also find them they've drawn moisture over time. And especially these up here in the middle, these are wax paper type. So basically it's aluminum with paper in between, and then all they do is kind of coat it in wax. And you can see here on this picture with the ends that that wax kind of breaks away. If these things start to get warm, the wax melts off. You'll often find little puddles of wax on the bottom plate of an amplifier when you remove it. It's because these things have gotten hot over time. The wax starts melting off. The more the wax melts off, the less they're sealed. The more they draw moisture, the more they break down, the more they get hot, etc. The degenerative cycle, basically. These, the poly caps of the modern ones, like this yellow one up here in the right, they hold up pretty well. They're sealed up pretty decently, but honestly, they haven't been around decades yet, so we'll see how they hold up in 30 or 40 years. And then down here in the bottom, you've got the kind of the old Russian paper and oil, or similarly, the Sprague vitamin C caps. They're made, and they're enclosed in a glass case inside of this metal case then. And they're basically sealed so that they will never draw moisture. So these things hold up extremely well. And you can see here from the picture holding up the end of it. You can see where they're sealed in this glass. So that's why these things are so popular. They have great sound, and they just hold up forever because they're sealed in this glass, and there's very little chance of moisture getting in there. And ultimately, it's the moisture that causes the dielectric to break down and cause you trouble. Hope that makes sense. Let's move on and talk a little bit about electrolytic capacitors. Okay, as you can see here, electrolytics are basically made similarly. The difference being with electrolytic here, you actually have multiple layers. So you kind of got this aluminum foil. Then you have this electrolyte. So it's actually something, it's a chemical based. Typically, it's almost like a paste inside of these things. Then you have an oxide layer, then a more aluminum foil, then a paper separator. So you kind of got a double whammy here. One, you've got capability of the paper separator drawing moisture, causing the same issue you had with the foil. But also this electrolyte layer over time will dry out. And that's why capacitors that are 50 years old, 40 years old, 30 years old, they're starting to fail these days. The electrolyte is breaking down. It's starting to dry out. And these capacitors, then look what happens. Basically, these aluminum foil layers start, you know, getting closer to each other. Then what happens? They produce heat. And once they start producing heat, then it causes this electrolyte to even break down and dry out even faster. So there again, a degenerative cycle just happens, you know, fairly abruptly, and these things start disintegrating over time. So similar scenario, slightly different setup, but you understand that it's got a similar set of problems here. Okay, I thought I'd show you a couple ways to kind of detect visually bad capacitors. You've already seen the black stuff coming out of the ends of capacitors I showed you earlier. But this is another telltale sign, and that is when you've got bulging happening on the top of capacitors, just like you see here. These things have actual cuts in them designed to split open to let the gases out if these things ever break down on the inside and overheat, versus them just blowing up anywhere. So it's kind of a controlled explosion here with the tops bulging like that. Here you can see, you can clearly see these are bulging at the top here, and this one over here is flat, which is still good. Okay, here you can see the dielectric has actually popped these tops open and started leaking out. This dielectric material that's used inside of some of these capacitors can be pretty nasty stuff. It's actually kind of corrosive and can eat away at things that it gets on. So just thought I'd show you that. Okay, another scenario I see from time to time, especially on little power supply boards inside of solid state receivers, you can actually see the electrolyte down here leaking out around the bottom of the capacitor. And that stuff, like I said, pretty acidic. Sometimes it'll eat away your etching. I've even had to rebuild traces around capacitors where that electrolyte ate up the traces as it came out. So keep an eye out for that as well. They don't always pop up and on the top. Sometimes they'll pop up and on the bottom, and the stuff will kind of ooze out. Now, this is one of the biggest mistakes I see by people just getting into the hobby. They see capacitors like this on a board, and they see this stuff around the bottom like this, and they immediately say, "Oh, my capacitors are leaking. Look at it. It's leaked all around there, this yellow stuff." Well, surprise, this is not a leaking capacitor. This is glue. And they did this during the construction process a lot of times. When you had a big, heavy component that the leads themselves wouldn't hold them in place for them to long enough to go through the mechanism to be soldered on the other side, they'd actually apply enough glue here to hold the capacitors down onto the board. So a good telltale sign if it's glue or not, if it's going way up on the capacitor like this over here on the right, it's glue. And you get a lot of times to replace a capacitor, you have to wiggle this stuff back and forth to kind of to get it to break free to let loose of the capacitor, if that makes sense. And just a few more pictures here. This might be very much what you would find under the little metal can.
cover in a Fender amplifier of vintage type. You'd have these four type electrolytics, and anytime you see the stuff bulging out of the holes in these things are bad and need replacing. And last up here is a leaky bad paper in oil, a wax paper capacitor. Well, how do you tell it's bad? Well, you don't visually. So I've showed you how to determine on electrolytics visually a little bit. It's really hard on these type capacitors. About the only thing you can go by is a bunch of the wax dripped off of it. But really, you've got to put one of these things under a meter to test them to know if they're leaking or not. Not a really good visual way, unless they've just exploded or or whatnot, to determine on a wax paper or a poly, an orange drop type capacitor per se.
And just a quick recap here today. I hope you've learned something. We've learned how to, the things you want to know about capacitor. What's its value? Is it leak or not? I.e. allowing DC to pass through. Has this thing got some internal resistance, which ultimately would call it to build up heat? Which, if you notice, I've got this little arrow drawn here, which ultimately causes it to leak, etc. And then, does this thing hold up well under high voltages or not? I think we've learned maybe ways to go about all of that today. Taught you a little bit about visual inspection, especially around electrolytics, how that's a lot easier than it is with these old, paper, wax paper type and poly and orange drop caps or whatnot. Hope you've also learned a little bit about why some of these hold up better than others over time. You've learned how to do a little bit of touch and feel for heat, or maybe use a digital thermometer. How to test its value, how to test its ESR, and how to determine if high voltage is causing a breakdown, and how 1 meter may not be able to do all of these. You may need a combination of this and this, and this and this are pretty much the same. If you're dealing with high voltage tube electronic, 400, 600 volt capacitors, you may need something like this, or you could kick it old school and just use a high voltage power supply here. It's the way I've done it for years. I'm just finding out this Sprague makes the whole setup process a lot quicker and simpler. So hopefully you've learned something, and throw me some questions out there, and certainly keep giving me feedback. I really appreciate all the viewers and everybody that's subscribed. Having a lot of fun making these videos. I know I could probably make them shorter, but I like to go in depth because I watch a lot of YouTube videos myself, and a lot of times I feel like people just scratch the surface on topics, and I'd like to know a little more. So you're going to get the verbose version from me, per se. Thanks again, everybody.